Hi, in this video, we'll be discussing about how to approach the question count a current multiplication. So this question, so when you get a question like this, like what is count a current multiplication or what is, how was urine concentrated, your introduction should contain the question why. Why is it important that urine should be concentrated? So basically it is because of this property of the kidneys that the plasma osmolality is maintained, right? So it is essential for the survival of mammals to live on land, that the urine is concentrated. And then you can also write about the normal value, that is the human kidneys can produce a maximal urine concentration of 1200 to 1400 milliosmol per liter. So that is a maximum concentration that our kidneys can attain. So after writing the brief introduction, you should write an outline of the mechanism of concentration of urine. So the basic requirements for forming concentrated urine are, first of all, there should be adequate antidiuretic hormone. So we know that this hormone, antidiuretic hormone, the short form of which is ADH, and it is also called vasopressin. It is a hormone which is produced from the pituitary, right? So this hormone is essential for concentration of urine. And then you can write that a high osmolarity of renal medullary interstitial fluid is required. That means another basic requirement is that the renal medulla should contain high osmolarity so that the urine can be concentrated. So how is this high concentration of renal medullary interstitium obtained? That is achieved by the juxtamedullary nephrons. So we know what are juxtamedullary nephrons. We have the cortical nephrons and the juxtamedullary nephrons. Juxtamedullary nephrons have long loop of Henle, and these are responsible for concentration of urine. Now, this high osmolarity is first established by, it is established by counter current multiplication and urea recycling, whereas it is maintained by counter current exchange. You should understand that these are two different terms, and each of this can be asked as a short note. So it is established by counter current multiplication and maintained by counter current exchange, which occurs in the vasa recta. So after writing that basic outline, we can write about counter current multiplication. So it begins in the loop of Henle, especially of the juxtamedullary nephrons. And why does it occur in the loop of Henle? Because of its special anatomical characteristics, right? So we know that the loop of Henle has got a thin descending limb and a thick ascending limb. Now this thick ascending limb is impermeable to water, but it is permeable to solutes. So you can write about there are transporters present on the thick ascending limb which transpose the solutes from this thick ascending limb into the interstitium, and it is called the sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter. So by the help of this transporter, sodium potassium and chloride are transported out of the thick segment of the ascending limb. Now what about thin descending limb? The descending limb of loop of Henle is permeable to water due to the presence of aquaporin. So water can freely move out of this thin descending limb into the interstitium. Now we'll see the various steps of counter current multiplication. So it begins at the thick ascending limb. So the solute is reabsorbed in the thick ascending limb. And then the tubular fluid in the thick ascending limb is hypoosmotic because all the solutes are being lost, right? And the interstitium is hyperosmotic. Okay, and then descending limb will go into osmotic equilibrium with the medullary interstitium. So the osmolarity of the tubular fluids in the descending limb will also increase. So so after explaining the basic steps, you can draw a diagram of this loop of Henle and then show how this concentration is established. Okay, so first suppose all the areas of the loop of Henle contains fluid of the same osmolarity, say suppose 300. So in the thin descending limb and also in the thick ascending limb, suppose the osmolarity is 300. In the interstitium also it is 300. Now we said that the multiplication begins in the thick ascending limb. So we've got a transporter here which is moving solutes from this thick ascending limb to the interstitium, right? So what will happen to the osmolarity in the thick ascending limb when solutes are being lost? It will decrease. So from 300, suppose it decreases to 200. Okay, What about in this interstitium? What will be the concentration gradient here? It has increased. It has become hyperosmolar. So this pump has the ability to maintain a concentration gradient of 200, which means the concentration gradient here will be 400, right? So here you can see that the concentration gradient in the interstitium has increased. In the thin descending limb, we'll just write it as 300 itself too, and we'll explain the next step in the next figure. So next figure, what will happen? There will be equilibrium between these two, the thin descending limb and the interstitium. So what will be the values? Here also, here it was 400, right? So in the thin descending limb also, it will be 400. They will equilibrate. Why? Because as I said before, this is permeable to water. So water will move out to maintain this equilibrium. Okay. So here it has become 400. Here also it has become 400. Here it was 200. 200 and 200. So here you can see that by this step itself, the concentration in the interstitium has increased. Now we have to write the next set of steps. So now new filtrate with solutes comes from the glomerulus. So what will happen? The hypertonic fluid in the descending limb will be pushed forward, right, into the ascending limb. And the thick ascending limb will again reabsorb the solute from it into the interstitium. The medullary interstitium osmolarity will further increase. So now we can demonstrate this concept by drawing the loop of Henle. So we said that new fluid is being pushed, right? So the concentration of that fluid is still 300. The previous fluid osmolarity was 400 and this is being pushed to the other side. Okay, so here it will be 400. And here also it will be 400. Now the previous fluid in this thick ascending limb had an osmolarity of 200, right? Now what will happen? And in the interstitium also, the fresh fluid was 300 before it was 400, right? Then we'll draw another loop of Henle, and here we can show that there is reabsorption of the solutes from the thick ascending limb into the interstitium. So now what will be the osmolarity here? It will decrease. So from 200, it will reach say around 150, and from 400, it will decrease to about 300. Okay. So what about the concentration of the osmolarity of the interstitium? It will increase. So from 300, it will be around 350, and from 300, it will be around say 500. I said the gradient will always be around 200 between the interstitium and the thick ascending limb. In the thin descending limb, we'll just write as it is, and we'll show what happens in the thin descending limb in the next diagram. So it's just 300, 300 and 400, 400. Now in the next diagram, you can show that there is fluid because it is permeable. There is loss of water from this thin descending limb so that the fluid can equilibrate. So suppose here it was 350, right? So the fluid in the thin descending limb will also become 350, and then it was 500 here. So the fluid here will also be 500. So here 500, here also 500. And in this part it was 300, 300, 150 and 150, right? So here you can see that a slight gradient is being established, right, from in the interstitium from 300 to 350. Now this step will continue until a proper gradient is being established. Okay. So after this whole thing, you will have steps take place at different levels, we'll see that there are the gradient will be something like this. So here it will be say 300, here it will be around say 700, here will be around 1000, and what was the maximum concentrating ability? 1200. So here also the osmolarity will be around say 100, then maybe say 500 and so on. Okay, here also there will be an increase in the osmolarity. So when you draw this diagram, you will know the concept of how the first step of counter current mechanism is taking place. That is how counter current multiplication is taking place. So after that, we have to write about the role of urea. So we know that urea is absorbed from the inner medullary collecting duct, right? It is absorbed from the inner medullary collecting duct, and from there it re-enters the medullary interstitium. Now from there, it will again enter the ascending limb of loop of Henle. okay, and then reach the collecting duct again, and from there it will be reabsorbed. So urea is one factor which is present in the interstitium which will maintain the hyperosmolarity. So maybe you can also draw this diagram showing how this urea, first it is filtered from the glomerula, from the glomerulus, it goes through the tubule until it reaches the collecting duct. From there it is reabsorbed by this transporter, and then it is transported back into the tubular fluid. Again it goes up, reaches the collecting duct, and this cycling of urea goes on. Okay, so that was the role of urea. Then you have to write about the role of ADH, that is antidiuretic hormone. So basically the permeability of the late distal tubule and the cortical collecting duct to water is controlled by the concentration of ADH or vasopressin. So the final urine osmolarity is maintained by this ADH action. So we know that ADH is secreted from the pituitary, and this ADH will act on the distal collecting convoluted tubule and the collecting duct, and it will maintain the, it will decide the final osmolarity based on the plasma osmolarity. So you can also write about the role of ADH. And finally, for the diagram, you can draw the first two diagrams which I had just shown. That is the first diagram showing the peculiar characteristics of the loop of Henle, that it is permeable to water and the thick acinoglym is permeable to solutes and impermeable to water. And also draw this diagram showing how the concentration, the renal medullary concentration is established. Okay, so this is counter current multiplication. Now for additional scoring points, you can also mention about the counter current exchanger. So once this counter current multiply system works, this osmolarity is maintained by this counter current exchanger. Okay, so we'll do another tutorial on that. You can also write about the obligatory urine volume, that means how much urine volume must the kidney excrete to excrete the minimum amount of solutes, which that is 0.5 liters per day. And you can also write about some clinical conditions in which the renal there is a disorder of concentrating ability of the kidneys, which are CR, that is syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion, and also about diabetes insipidus. So that will give a completion for your answer and enhance your marks. So that's about it. I hope the concept is clear and you know what to write when such a question like counter current multiplication comes. Thank you.